Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. King Jehoram was negatively influenced by his heathen wife. Soon after being crowned king, he sent out death squads to murder his six brothers and their families. Lucifer used Athaliah to reintroduce idolatry and restore the high places where people could dance, drink, and fornicate while worshiping their demon god. These repulsive and rebellious acts did not go unnoticed in heaven. Jesus withdrew the protection from Judah, and the Philistines and Arabs attacked Jerusalem, plundered the palace, and killed all of Jehoram's wives and children except for Athaliah and her youngest son. Although Elijah was a prophet in Israel, God instructed him to write a message of judgment against the wayward king. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Well, praise the Lord and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church Worldwide. And I'm going to be talking about King Jehoram today. Now, I have had people contacting me, and they simply saying this, you know, we're tired of hearing about the kings of Israel and Judah. Can't you get another subject? You know, we want to hear something else. Well, the problem is this. I write my own sermons. I don't buy them from Warren. I don't go buy from other people. And I simply write my own sermons. How do I write them? God tells me what to write. He told me to preach on the kings. Like I said in to people, I have studied them, but I was not interested in them. I felt, you know, I knew a little bit, but never looked at it. But the kings represents you and me. These were men that simply got corrupted. Some of them did not get corrupted. And they actually represent the human race. They got so many years, and then the plug is pulled, and they die. And that's why we're going to finish up the kings of Judah. That's what we got left. So let's pray right now. My Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you right now for these moments I have here on this first Sunday in 2022. And I pray right now, Lord, that you will anoint me, speak through me. Let your Holy Spirit today bring forth a strong message so that, Father God, people will hear, we will repent, we will change, and we will walk with you. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen. If you want to be ready for a scripture, turn to 2 Chronicles chapter 18. That's 2 Chronicles chapter 18. And what God showed me to do is this. We have a virtual time run. And also, most of the time we look upon things from below. Now we're going to look upon things from above. How does God think? The God had angrily stopped the virtual time run after the death of Jehoshaphat. They had rebuked him twice, and in each instance, he refused to repent and acknowledge that he was wrong. Jehoshaphat, for political reasons, established an alliance with King Ahab of Israel. when he allowed his son Jehoram to marry Ahab and Jezebel's daughter Athaliah. In 2 Chronicles chapter 1, we read this. Now Jehoshaphat had riches and honor in abundance and joined affinity with Ahab. That is marriage, a political marriage between two countries, between two governments. And then 21, in the same 2 Chronicles 21, we read this from verses 5 and 6. Jehoram was 32 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. And he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, like as did the house of Ahab. For he had the daughter of Ahab to wife, and he wrought that was evil in the eyes of the Lord. It's extremely important that when you marry somebody that is walking with the Lord. I'm talking to Christians now. If you are an ungodly person, you don't have that, you simply stumble along. But in this case now, if you marry the right person, a man or a woman, it will determine the rest of your life. Now, Jehoram, he could have simply said when he was a teenage boy, I don't want to marry Ahab's daughter and Jezebel's daughter. She's the idol worshiper. She's a witch. I don't want to do that. I want to walk with God. But Jehoram made a choice as a young man to marry the wrong woman. It cost him his own life. He only lasted for 8 years. He had a number of wives. They all got killed. They had a lot of children. They got killed. And everything that he had lived for turned to dust. Now, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, they were sitting there in heaven, and they were talking. And since they could read thoughts of humanity, they knew Jehoshaphat's reasoning behind the alliance. He had felt there would be no more wars between Israel and Judah if the two royal families were bonded together by marriage. Jehoshaphat ignored Jesus' warning about uniting with pagan worshipers, and that God had watched the royal wedding of Jehoram and Athaliah in disgust. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 7. That is Deuteronomy chapter 7. And we're going to land and read here from verse number 1. Actually, let's go from verse number 5 and 6. No, I want to go from verse 1. When the Lord your God shall bring you into the land where you go to possess it, and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than you. And when the Lord your God shall deliver them before you, you shall smite them, utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them, nor show mercy unto them. Neither shall you make marriages with them. Your daughter you shall not give unto his son, nor his daughter shall you take unto your son. For they will turn away your son from following me, that they may serve other gods. So will the anger of the Lord be kindled against you, and destroy you suddenly. For they will turn away your son from following me, for they may serve other gods, so they will anger the Lord to kindle against you and destroy you suddenly. But this shall you deal with them. You shall destroy their altars, break down their images, cut down their groves, and burn their grave with images with fire. If you go out today, let's say you go to bars, gambling places, casinos, whatever it is, dance halls, and other places of ill repute, you will find a lot of men and women there, and many of them came from Christian homes. They were raised in Christian families. And they made a choice. When they got older, 16, 17, and up and in years, they simply made a decision. I'm going to marry this person. It might be a man or a woman. They're not walking with the Lord. And some, I've heard people say this about, you know, I'm going to do some evangelism with time. I'm going to bring him to Christ. I'm going to bring her to Christ. It doesn't work that way. It goes the other way. They bring you to the devil. And so it's a disaster. What should we do if you're a young person? If you're smart, you simply say this, I don't want to repeat what generations have done. I'm going to be smart. I'm going to ask God to give me the right spouse, the right man or the right woman. As the God I was talking about, they realized that Jehoram was only 32 years old. He was ready to ascend to Judah, the throne of Judah. Athaliah used sexual debauchery to seduce Jehoram into Baal worship. Do we do that today? You know, I decided I'm not going to research the sexual department in the world. But I have heard glimpses. I see some advertisement. And I do know that there are channels, probably on television, that cater to sexual activities. There are stores, I understand, where, you know, you have stores, they sell tobacco. You have these new shops, you know, the vapor shops, and you got liquor shops, and there are sex shops. And there's all kind of gadgets, all kind of equipment now that has been designed over the years, including sex dolls. And so there's a tremendous market out there. And so people that are married, they get dirty. They simply are taken down. And so our nation is getting filthy. As a result, now with Jehoram, he became demon-possessed. He became addicted to the deviation associated with the worship of his idol. I don't know how many women we had going through deliverance. And they told us, you know, their husbands, you know, wanted to have sexual deviations. And they said, what do we do? My husband demands it. And we says, well, this is where you got to draw the line. You're going to simply say in the name of Jesus, I will not make myself filthy. I will not sin. But he will beat me. He will do this and that. when you got to stand up. And the God had looked down upon Jehoram, and they realized this, that this here is not going to go well. They wondered if Judah was headed to disaster when Lucifer achieved control over Jehoram. If I had supernatural power, I could bring in here today at least 20 men and women, stand them up here behind me, that used to be in our ministry. Some of them are dead. Some of them are walking away from the Lord. Some of them are into drinking alcohol, homosexuality, and all kinds of different things. And these men and women, one time, were in our ministry, raising their hands, worshiping the Lord, praising God, reading their Bibles, and you would think, man, this guy's going to go far. He's going to go very far in the kingdom of heaven. And they all got taken down. Some of them lost their lives. Some are just walking in life like Jehoram do, just wasting their years on earth. It's a cutthroat world out there. The demons are vicious. And unless we walk in the Spirit and listen to God, we will not last. Remaining true to their commitment to the trial of Lucifer and the fallen angels, they were not happy, but they resumed their virtual time run. And they simply said this, if it gets too bad, we will terminate Jehoram. Let's look upon what happened now when we had the virtual time run. Now, King Jehoshaphat's funeral saw the family and various dignitaries gathered in Jerusalem. If you've been to funerals, and I've done, some of them I've officiated, I had family, people have died in my family, at the funerals. You know, at a funeral, there's a lot of crocodile tears. People, you know, they just red eyes, you know, crocodile tears, you know, they're not really sorry, but, you know, they're good actors. And they're just waiting for the coffin to be dropped in the hole, or if they have cremation, for that to take place, so they can start the fight over the inheritance. I want you to see this particular funeral. And King Jehoram, I'm sure he had his wife Athaliah there, his children, they were dressed up, he had brothers, and they were there cordially shaking hands, and he would say, okay, brothers, you know, I'm sorry Dad died, you know, and so on. It's a sad day for us. And he was as cold, as an ice cold as a mafia boss. Because in his mind he said, you know, hey, let's get the funeral over. We're not gonna fight over the inheritance. You're going to die. I will see to that. Turn out to 2 Chronicles chapter 21. 2 Chronicles chapter 21. And I'm going to pick it up here from verse number 3. And their father gave them great gifts of silver and of gold, precious things with fenced cities in Judah. But the kingdom gave it to Jehoram because he was firstborn. Not necessarily he was the brightest guy, but he was the firstborn. So Jehoshaphat simply said, you know, Jehoram is going to be the next king, but all my sons, I want to bless them. I'm going to put them in different cities. They're going to be running that city as a mayor, and I'm going to give them silver and gold, and they're not going to want anything. I'm going to make sure they got well taken care of. We go down now, drop down to verse number 6 again here. Let's go up to verse number 4. Now when Jehoram was risen up to the kingdom of his father, he strengthened himself and slew all his brethren with a sword, and divers also the princes of Israel. In other words, he took care of the opposition, his brothers, his own brothers. He sent out death squads, killed the brothers, the wives, children. There were other political aristocrats in Judah that necessarily didn't like Jehoram. And he sent death squads over there. And so now Jehoram, filled, possessed by demons, having a witch as a wife, he simply was ice cold, and he killed all these people while he smiled toward the population and said, you know, I really care for Judah. I really care for your people. You know, we're going to have this welfare program. We're going to do this and that. He didn't care for anyone except himself. He was 32 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 8 years in Jerusalem. And he walked in the way of the kings of Israel, like as did the house of Ahab. We had the daughter of Ahab to wife, Athaliah, and he wrought that which was evil in the eyes of the Lord. Howbeit, the Lord will not destroy the house of David, because of the covenant he had made with David, as he promised to give light to him and his son forever. Now, as a result of this, God simply said, I remove my blessings. In verse number 8, in his days, the Edomites revolted from under the dominion of Judah and made themselves a king. Then Jehoram went forth with his princes and all his chariots with him, and he rose up by night and smote the Edomites, who compassed him in, and the captains of the chariots. So the Edomites revolted from under the hand of Judah unto this day. The same time also did Libnah revolt from under his hand, because he had forsaken the Lord, God of his fathers. When you're not walking with the Lord, things are not going to do well. There's going to be problems. Things are not working out. And from being blessed, you have nothing but repair jobs, strife, and all kind of difficulties. Verse 11. Moreover, he made high places in the mountains of Judah, caused the inhabitants of Jerusalem to commit fornication, and compelled, that means he simply forced them and said, this is what we're going to do. I'm thinking of this concert they had in Texas last year, where they brought in, I don't know how many thousands of people they had there. And these young people, with no control, there was a stampede. Many got killed. Many got injured really badly and probably are still not recovered. And there was what we used to call in the old days sex, rock and roll, and drugs. And people thought it was fun. But really, it leads to disaster. And we have today all kinds of difficulties. Our nation right now is in a balance. The Supreme Court will rule within a short time on abortion. We do not know how the judges are going to go. Remember to have a free will. But there's no doubt in my mind that God wants them to rule where simply Roe versus Wade, we cannot put on the side. Abortion, the issue of abortion will be given to the states. And there are many states today where they are simply don't want to have abortions. And if you go that road, if the Supreme Court go that road, it will be pleasing to God, and we might get some reprieve as a nation. But you know what it takes? It takes prayer. Let me ask you this question now, and I don't want to be nasty, I just want to ask you this, because I think that we simply are not thinking through. How many of you, on a daily basis, take 5 minutes in the morning and say, God, I want to take 5 minutes right now, I want to concentrate on one thing, the Supreme Court. I want to pray for those conservative judges, that they will have the guts, they will have the stamina to rule for life. I would say this. If we have, let's say we have 100 million people that they say they're Christians. If there are 10 people on a daily basis that pray for the Supreme Court, that's a high number. Because I think that you and I have not really understood what we can do with prayer. So if you really want to see something happen, let's not just complain and say, well, everything going to hell in a handbasket. Let's focus on certain things that can happen. How many of us are praying on a daily basis for Joe Biden to stop breathing so they can put him away? I'm one of them. We prayed for Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and eventually God pulled the plug on her. You see, we might not be in Washington, D.C., we might not have a lot of power, but you put in 5 minutes a day, and there are certain things that you target in prayer and say, you know, God, I'd like to see you move here, I'd like to see you move there. And if thousands of us will do that, we will move the hand of God, Satan will be pushed aside, and there will be victory. How many churches do you hear someone say this? We always thinking about, well, God, you know, please lower the gas prices. And God says, you know, I'm not interested in the gas prices. I'm interested in you stop killing children. I'm interested in that you stop going to the high altars. I want to see some change. God, I need this, I need that. And God says, I don't want to hear that. That's not what you need. It's what you need to do. Now, here comes a prophet. in verse number 12, and they came in writing to him from Elijah the prophet, saying, why did Elijah not go down? He was old at this time. He was at the end of his life. Thus says the Lord God of David, your father, because you have not walked in the ways of Jehoshaphat, your father, nor in the ways of Asa, king of Judah, but has walked in the way of the kings of Israel, has made Judah inhabitants of Jerusalem to go whoring, like to the whoredoms of the house of Ahab, and also have slain your brethren of your father's house, which were better than yourself. Behold, with a great plague will the Lord smite your people and your children and your wives and all your goods, and you shall have great sickness by disease of your bowels, until your bowels fill up a reason of sickness day by day. That's not a nice letter to get. I'm sure that Jehoram was not very pleased when he heard that read to him. Now, it happened just like Elijah had prophesied. But look in verse number 14 now. Behold, with great plague will the Lord smite your people and your children and your wives and all your goods. I'm thinking about Colorado this morning. Colorado is a very liberal state, particularly in the eastern part of it. And we saw this huge fire that burned down about 1,000 homes plus in just a few hours this last week. And we saw it, but you know, everything continued. It was on the news for maybe one day. And after that, you know, it was a New Year's revelries and having fun. But I thought about that. First of all, the stupidity of building these homes in a cluster form, communities. In Sacramento, I've seen homes, you know, about, there might be 10 feet, 8 feet between the homes. It's like putting down card boxes. You make a subdivision of them. If you got the right wind and you got fire, they're only going to burn. 1,000 families today lost everything. Clothing, computers, furniture, whatever they had, they just had to walk out, they had to run. And now they're scrambling. Do they have fire insurance? Where are they going to live? They're homeless. It can happen that fast. Was that God's will? I think it was a judgment. It was a judgment saying, listen, Colorado, you have flaunted sin in my face, and I'm sick of it. Here in California, we have the fires. We have the drought. God is sick of the sin. You got this yo-yo that called himself a governor. He's going to do all kinds of different things. He's like a court jester. He's the most stupid guy in this world. He doesn't realize there's a God. And God is not pleased. And you shall have great sickness by disease of the bowels, until the bowels fill up a reason of the sickness day by day. I've seen people that I had in church. They walk with the Lord. They turn around and change from one halfway to the other. Some of them are 6 feet on the ground today. Some of them are very ill, that life is about over. The question is, are you going to change? In verse number 16, the good times are over. And the good times could be over for us, because I think that most people in America have not understood Putin and Xi in China. These two men are demon-possessed. They are controlled by archons over Russia, over China. They want more territory. China has a long time wanted to take revenge for the opium wars that we forced on them 100 years ago. Putin is not a friend of America. They are looking now what they can do. We got this yo-yo in the White House. We got the idiots that are running his cabinets. We got a military that's not really ready. And if Putin decides to move, he got 100,000 troops to start moving into Ukraine and rolling Ukraine up. At the same time, Xi start moving on Taiwan. What's the United States going to do? We had this scenario back in 1956. Israel wanted to go and clobber Egypt and take the Sinai Peninsula. So what did they do? Well, they organized a revolt in Hungary. And you got an uprising in Hungary. So suddenly the United States had two conflicts happening. And guess what? They sacrificed the Hungarians to save the Israelites. If they go in Ukraine and in Taiwan, it's going to be, we're not going to be able to do a whole lot. The troops in Europe are not ready for combat. They're spread out. If you want to understand that, think Korea, 1950, when the communists suddenly just breached and just ran south. We almost got pushed in the ocean before they were able to stop it. And then the war lasted for 3 years back and forth, and we couldn't win that war. We lost 50,000 men that died. This year could be a nasty year. So the thing we got to watch for is, what does God do? Verse number 16 now in 2 Chronicles 16. More of the Lord stirred up against Jehoram the spirit of the Philistines and the Arabians that were near the Ethiopians. Moreover, the Lord stirred up against Jehoram the spirit of the Philistines and the Arabians that were near the Ethiopians. God moved upon the Ethiopians and on the Arabs and simply said, go. And they came up into Judah and break into it, carried away all the substance was found in the king's house, his sons also, and his wives. So there was never a son left him, save Jehoahaz, the youngest of his sons. They came to the palace. Now Jehoram, when he heard a prophecy, he should have simply said, you know, man, it's only one thing to do. I need to repent. But he was stubborn. And now the Arabians, the Ethiopians, invaded Judah, came all the way to Jerusalem, took the town, got to his palace. He and his wife, Athaliah, one son that he had, fled. They took all his belongings, all his goods, killed all his family. Did he repent? No. If Jehoram would have been smart, he would have simply put himself sackcloth, ashes, dropped to his knees and said, God, I have sinned against you, like King David prayed. I'm guilty. I want to repent. Please, God, forgive me. But it was not in him. There comes a time when you get so hard, that you cannot repent. I remember one time, we had a camp out. We used to have good times up in the Sierras, we'd go camping in the summertime, take the whole church with us. And we had an evening devotion. I had different people, different men speak. I call them mystery speakers. I remember that one night, as we were on the fire, the big, nice big fire, we're sitting there and so on, that one young man stood up. And he said, I need God. He was weeping. Have you prayed with him? Today, he's cold as ice. He lost it. He has no desire for God. He's as cold as a slab of ice. In another camp that we had, I remember a young man, and I'm not putting names on this. And he came to me after people had gone to bed, we were in our tents, and he said, I need to repent. I've sinned. I said, fine, got a Bible out, prayed with him, made sure he was saved. He prayed and repented of his sins and says, God, I want to walk with you. Very talented young man. Both the men I'm talking about, very talented, very intelligent, smart. The second one, he did the follow-up. He got in the wrong crowd. They had some cousins. And he started drinking. And drinking. One day, he was drunk, him and his cousins, decided to drive home under the influence of alcohol, got to the car, high speed, inside the Sacramento area, ran a red light in intersection, killed a woman, injured a husband. And then he ran and called the police and said, somebody stole my car. But they nailed him. Today he's in prison. He lost 15 years of his life. But that woman can never come back. She went. He sent her to eternity. Why? Why do things happen like that? Because we have not understood the power of demons, the power of Satan. You cannot sin and think you can contain it. It's as stupid as you think, you know. I need some fire. I put it in my pocket, in my coat. You can't carry fire in your coat pocket. It doesn't work. It will burn through. That's what happened to Jehoram. Now, the next verse, 18. After all this, the Lord smote him in the bowels with the incurable disease. Could have been cancer, rapid cancer. But notice now, folks, the Lord smote him. Yes, God puts disease on people as a punishment. We need to understand that. God is a God of love, but he's also a God of judgment. Did he repent? And it came to pass that in the process of time, after the end of 2 years, his bowels fell out by reason of sickness. So he died of sore diseases. He was in pain for 2 years. Why didn't Jehoram during that time say, God, I got it. I got my family killed. Now I'm here sick. I got it, Lord. I'm ready to repent. But he didn't do it. I got a cousin living in Sweden. He's still alive. I remember I came back probably about 1971, 72. We came back to Sweden to have revival meetings. And I looked up his mom and dad and him. He was younger then. And I remember talking to my aunt. Her name was Ingrid, Aunt Ingrid. I liked her. When I was a small boy, she had more money than my parents had. And she was nice to us, me and Peter. And she always took good care of us. She was a good woman. So I remember Aina and I coming over to the town where they were in Falköping. They had a store. And we went down to the store, and there was my aunt there by herself. She was running the store. And I said, Aunt Ingrid, I want to talk to you about Jesus. I saw her face changed. Her eyes got cold. And she said, don't give me that S. I don't hear it. Now she's dead in hell. She hears those words echoing over and over again. My uncle also died without Christ. Now their son, hard, cold as a slab of ice. I witnessed to him, my brother witnessed to him. He has no desire. No desire. One foot to the grave, the other foot to the banana peel. He lived a good life, good job, good family, good wife, no problem there. And that's the end of him. Will you make it? I prayed for him the other day. I said, God, please give him a chance. But let me tell you this. When you simply reject God, you get a reprobate mind. You don't care. That's a terrible place to be in. Verse 20. 32 years old was Jehoram when he began to reign. He reigned in Jerusalem 8 years. He got 8 years and departed without being desired. In other words, the population said, good riddance. Let's get rid of that guy, just like we say about Joe Biden. Let them go. We don't want him. We're not going to cry when Joe Biden kicked the bucket. We're going to despise him. How great they buried in the city of David, but not in the sepulchres of the kings. He didn't get a place of honor. He got a place of shame. Jehoram, 8 years as a king. Look at my summary, and I want them to go with me to Mark chapter 8. That's the Gospel of Mark chapter 8. As we apply this to us today, you can see right now, the kings do apply to us. They represent us. They were loose like us. Their mistakes, the good stuff they did, is something we need to look at. And we need to say, I don't want to be like King Jehoram. I want to walk with God. In Mark chapter 8, we pick it up in verse number 34. Mark 8, 34. And when he, Jesus, called the people unto him, with his disciples also, he said unto them, whosoever would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. Have you taken up your cross? Are you following Jesus? For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. You want to lose your life in Jesus. You want to simply say, Jesus, I want you to live in me. I want you to live through me. Amen. I don't want to sin. I don't want to do that. This morning, as I was checking for if you had a prayer request on things, I joined another Facebook. It's a conservative group. It's called Expert, I think it is. Sapit. And I got a requester for friendship. So there was nothing, just a name, a woman's name. So I clicked on to see who she was. She was laid out like a piece of meat in a store when you go and want to buy some meat. And she had written the caption, you know, hi, how are you? Click. She's not going to be my friend. That's how the devil does. Now, if I would have said, you know, that looks interesting. She's a nice looking young lady. Maybe if I have contact with her, I can lead her to Christ. Yeah. No, that's not how you evangelize. That's when you hit the delete button. Verse 36. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? With other words, I'm asking you right now what Jesus asked. What shall it profit a man if you gain the whole world and lose your own soul? Verse 38. Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him shall also the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. So you are saved. You're still walking with the Lord. But let me ask you this. When it comes time for you to lose your body and you'll be taken to heaven, and you walk through the pearly gates, what do you want Jesus to say? Welcome, you faithful servant. Welcome, come home. Would you want to see Jesus? Simply, oh no, man. Oh, not this guy. I don't want to see him. You make a decision on earth right now. Remember I told you this? You and I do not know when our time is up on this earth. I'm planning like I got at least 25, 30 years left to go. I know that you're planning, you got left to go. But you know what? We can get a tap on the shoulder anytime when an angel's saying, time to go. You're not going to say to him, I got a couple of things I got to fix at my desk first. I got to call that person first. No. When the tap comes on your shoulder, that's it. You're done. You're finished. For better or for worse. For whosoever shall save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the Gospels, the same shall save it. If you want to save your life, I'm not talking about salvation right now, but save your life, to save for eternity. Lose your life in Jesus. Lose yourself in Him. And say, Jesus, I surrender all. He will take you. You can be a Jehoram. You can be like the two different men I shared with you here today. These were young teenage men when I had them here in the church. And today, they are older, in their 30s, 40s. One in prison. One couldn't care less about God. He will have a day. The day will come. The knock will be on his shoulder. And he would hear the words, time to go. For better, for worse, you're going to go out into eternity. How do we close a message like this? Here's what I want you to do. This is what I feel the Holy Spirit is telling me what to do. First of all, if you're not saved, you need to get saved. Confess that you're a sinner. Simply say, I'm a sinner. I'm not born again. God, I need to be saved. God, forgive me of my sins. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe He died on the cross. I believe He rose on the third day. I believe He paid for my sins. I'm going to apply it now. I want to repent. Forgive me. Jesus, come in. He will forgive you. Got good news for you. When we finish here, the screen will change for you. I say that every Sunday. Three questions will come up and you will hear the voice of Pastor Charles. He will say, my friend, and then he will take you through the scriptures, have a prayer with you, make sure that you are saved. Will you do that? And then call us, write us, let us know, have the joy that you became a born again today so we can rejoice with you. Go to our website, the phone number there, you have an email there. You can send a letter to us. To you that are saved, I know that some of you are walking very close with God. Some of you walking a little bit less, some less and so on. But would you take an inventory today, like I asked you before? Will you take 5 minutes every day to pray for the Supreme Court until we have a right decision? Would you examine your life and say, am I hot or cold? Am I really where I should be, or am I wasting my time? Dear brother and sister in Christ, if I can urge you anything, don't waste any time. Ask Jesus to help you to walk in such a way that you are productive. And when the call comes for you to go home, you can say, I'm ready. Here's Brother Thomas.
So, good morning. I had a conversation with a Christian brother on New Year's Eve. And I told him that I can't fathom in my mind how we can get this president that we have. He's portrayed on the media as being a fool, senile, stuff like that. And so he said to me, well, maybe it's a judgment from God against him personally, that he's losing his faculties, and that it's for the stealing of the election. And I thought that was a plausible explanation. So, because I just couldn't fathom how you could have that seat, President of the United States, and be so, debased. But anyway, I just thought I'd put that out there as food for thought. And I believe Pastor John nailed it when he said the thrust that needs to take place in the year 2022 is prayer, prayer, prayer. I do believe that. I believe that it will hold back and will stem the evil tide. So I met with some guys and we started 2022 in prayer. And it was good. So we're going to close out. Father God, thank you for the word here spoken today. Thank you for the ability to discern the scriptures and to see the depth of it and not to just, pass right over it, but to get what you intended for us to get out of the scriptures. It's an amazing. And I thank you for the Bible studies that are going on around the world with men of God, women of God, and how crucial they are. I thank you for the remnant that is being raised up in these last days. And I thank you, Father God, for the ability to maintain your joy through it all, because it is horrendous, the attack on the people. And I call it full spectrum warfare. And also recognize, as the scriptures pointed out today, the demonic rulers over the territories, and that they are. I see that in my travels also, Lord, where there's a personality to every city, and so we come against those demonic rulers, no matter what country in the world. It seems to be like They're all hell-bent on war. And, that just wipes out more people. We thank you for our many blessings, Lord. We thank you for a good year in 2022. Lead us and guide us. Let us know when to speak. Let us know when to keep silent. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth, and your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are. You've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person. Doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? Even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood, so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the 52nd part in the series, The Origin Story of Jesus, and was entitled, The Kings of Judah. King Jehoram was negatively influenced by Athaliah. Soon after his coronation, he sent out death squads to murder his six brothers and their families. Athaliah was a priestess of Baal, and Lucifer used her to reintroduce idolatry and restore the high places so people could dance, drink, and fornicate while worshiping their demon god. These repulsive and rebellious acts did not go unnoticed in heaven. Jesus withdrew protection from Judah so that the Philistines and Arabs attacked Jerusalem, plundered the palace, and killed all of Jehoram's wives and children, with the exception of Athaliah and her youngest son. Although Elijah was a prophet in Israel, God instructed him to write a message of judgment. There was no clause for repentance for the evil Jehoram had done, and 2 painful years later his bowels fell out and he died. Jehoram never accomplished anything of eternal value. The people of Jerusalem despised him, and there was no grief over his death. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1841. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.